How do you feel about piracy? You wouldn't steal a car, would you? I mean, if I could download it. Welcome back to Technality. I'm Jacqueline Swan, and today we're going to be sailing the seven seas online. Why? Because I have way too many subscription services to pay for. Disclaimer, I'm not condoning piracy. This is a video for educational purposes. The internet has changed the idea of ownership. From everyone seemingly moving to subscription services, to companies controlling the use of your physical purchases, to piracy sites running on the belief that everyone should have access to media, there is a battle of sorts being waged over what it means to own what. But let's just focus on media files for a second. Books, music, video games, how many have you bought and downloaded and have on your computer? I'm talking about files that don't require access to the internet or a third-party connection to use. For a lot of you, that's probably close to zero. For example, you might think you own your games because you bought them on Steam. Wrong. In the terms of service, you will find that you are purchasing a non-exclusive, non-transferable, non-sub-licensable, limited right and license to use one copy of the game for your personal, non-commercial use for gameplay. What does that mean? Well, it means you don't own the game. Steam is just giving you access to use the game. That's why you have to be connected to Steam to play your games. Of course, you can make them offline, but you still have to go through Steam's service client. So you can't resell it, you can't make a backup to it, you can't let your friend play it either. Which also means that if Steam goes under, you lose access to your Steam library. I mean, you can hope that Steam will make the games accessible even after they go under, but if you email support and ask them the question, you get a canned response along the lines of, in the unlikely event of the discontinuation of the Steam network, measures are in place to ensure that all users will continue to have access to their Steam games. Which isn't saying anything until they put something in the end user agreement. They're not liable to do anything. They don't have to make them accessible. But until we see something about what would happen when they go under in an end user agreement, they don't have to do anything. And you agreed to all of that in the terms of service. But this control over how you use what you bought is starting to seep into the physical world. If you violate PS4's terms of service, they can disable use of the PS4 system online or offline, which means they can brick the system if they don't like the way you're using it. So you don't even have a say in how you use that physical console you bought. You have to follow Sony's definition of it to the letter, or they can brick you. They can just use your internet connection to shut it down. So you can't jailbreak it, you can't use an unauthorized third-party controller, you can't return it to a previous version of the software. In this case, it doesn't matter that you can't download a PS4. Sony just wants to make sure that you are using their product in the way they want you to use the product. We're also seeing this with cars and workout equipment, so it's not just exclusive to the world of media. Well, mainly to make more money, because once I sell you something, you're done as my customer. Unless certain things that make the product useful are subscription-based. Like the motorcycle airbag vest that will stop working if you miss a payment. Even safety features are going subscription-based. And if a product is tied to your internet and account, you can't lend or resell it to a friend, they'll have to get their own. Even how you dole out your streaming service accounts is beginning to be affected. Netflix is in the process of trying to limit accounts to just 4 pre-approved devices. So you wouldn't be able to just log in from anywhere you have an internet connection. You'll have to do it from a specified device, which is frustrating because I pay for that account. I want to be able to access the content wherever I go. That's the purpose of streaming. If it's locked to my TV, it's just cable. And Netflix hasn't exactly been nailing the content in recent years, but they have been nailing me on the price point. So we'll see how long that subscription lasts. But there is a response to all this on the other end of what ownership is online. Piracy. Piracy has grown over the years because of the ease of access and the arguable ethics behind it. The laws are pretty clear on piracy, all because you had to watch the last season of Game of Thrones, which is a punishment in itself. So in the eyes of the law, there really isn't a gray area. However, you've probably pirated something online. Whether it's downloading music with a YouTube downloader, cracking a version of Adobe software, or typing in the name of a textbook followed by free PDF, you're a criminal. But if you actually ask people, they probably won't see any of that as being wrong or even illegal. Reportedly, 130 billion visits were made globally to piracy sites in 2020. Besides not having to pay, there are a lot of reasons behind why people pirate. And generally, those reasons come from being unsatisfied with the industry. People download video games so they don't have to deal with DRM, which is how licensing is handled for digital assets. DRM can slow down performance, require you to be online for an offline game, and if the server goes down, you lose access to your purchase forever. All because a company doesn't want you to resell or legally make a copy of that content. They want you and you alone to have sole access to that product. And to see this argument that people will pay as long as it's consumer friendly, you just need to take a look at a younger Netflix. The streaming platform's original content strategy involved looking at the material people pirated. Why? Well, hosting the content people were looking for on an easily accessible platform made it worth the money to save time. So much so that BitTorrent, a popular file sharing service, lost 50% of its Canadian users when Netflix launched there. That's according to Reed Hastings, Netflix co-founder. So people are willing to pay and abide by IP law as long as it's consumer friendly. But industries have become less consumer friendly over the years. Just the streaming industry alone, content is being fractured across multiple sites as more companies create their own streaming platforms. Now it's costly and you have to juggle different subscriptions. And if I have to pay for another platform that only has one show I want to watch, theoretically, I might just go look elsewhere for that content. And while you can't necessarily download a car, 3D printing and being able to learn anything online might start to change that. I mean, Ivan Sench, a programmer from New Zealand, 3D printed a functioning 1961 Aston Martin DB4. The car is a classic that can go for hundreds of thousands. But Sench spent a little over $2,000 on materials using the base of a 1993 Nissan Skyline. So, turns out you can download a car. The rise in 3D printing, open source blueprints online, and the ability to learn whatever you want from the DIY community might start to disrupt companies trying to control physical products. And while the tech isn't accessible to everyone yet, life finds a way. And as we've seen, companies will lose to pirates. When one site is shut down, five more spring up. Piracy has innovated file sharing to get around companies and laws trying to stop them. And a lot of people don't really think twice about the legality behind piracy. Reportedly, 70% of online users find nothing wrong with it. So as consumers are pulled around by companies online and offline, we might start to see a shift in the market again. So as companies continue to take control over what we can and can't do with the products we buy, we have to ask ourselves going forward. What rights do we as consumers want to have for the products we bought? Thank you so much for watching. I would love to hear your thoughts in the comment section below. How do you feel about this? Do you think you should be able to determine how you use your PS4? If you enjoyed the video, give it a thumbs up and remember to subscribe to Technality for more future content.